So, with Mel now safely locked behind bars, and having finally gotten some concrete connection linking both Kathy and Emma, I think it's time we finally got back on the trail of finding our missing friend. First thing we want to do is to try to pick up that film that got developed, with the emphasis on try, because, yeah, there is going to be a little bit of a hitch in that. Right off the bat, the shop owner does make a strange mention of Winona. And the reason they do that is because Winona has already come by and picked up the developed pictures before us. Bit odd that Winona would do that. Makes it seem like maybe there's something in those pictures he wants to see before Matthew sees them. I'd say it's almost suspicious, but I don't really think Winona has done anything else to really pop up on our radar as a possible suspect. Still, if anything, as far as I know, there's no way to really get the pictures ahead of Winona. It just seems like a dead-set story event. And I really can't reprimand the store owner here for giving the pictures away. They do know that there is some connection between Matthew and Winona, so it's not like pictures were given away to a stranger. That does mean we are going to have to hunt down Winona at some point this afternoon, though there's something else I want to do beforehand, and it was something we learned, I guess not only from a note we found in Mel's room, but also from Emma's diary itself. Yeah, we learned that, I guess, Emma and Kathy did have plans to meet up with Mel on the 23rd, and we learned that meetup was to happen at the motel, and as you can imagine, well, there's not very many motels in Mazerna Falls. There's not very much of anything in this small town. And in fact, the one sole motel is on the lovely Lakeside Vista here. And to keep with where it's situated, it has the quaint name of the Lakeview Inn. All right, Lakeside Inn. It's here that hopefully we can piece together some additional information from what I hope is a very helpful receptionist. And like any good receptionist, the first thing they want to do is try to offer us a room. And indeed, we are looking for a particular room, but first, we want to get a little bit of information. And the good thing is, from that note, not only were we able to find a specific date, but we were also able to find a specific time that all three of them might have been here. The problem is that we are still just a random teen, even with our newly obtained sheriff's badge. Still doesn't really give us the power to just demand information from people. But since we are just trying to get some very basic information, nothing too sensitive like a social security number or credit card number, the receptionist is a little bit more willing to try to help us. And the good thing is, since the motel is fairly small, there weren't very many people staying here that day. In fact, room 1, for some reason, has country rock singer Linda Ronstadt staying here. I have no idea if this is supposed to be some weird little inside joke. But, they decide to include Linda Ronstadt as a random celebrity passing through town. Though it doesn't seem like Matthew is much of a fan. Doesn't really seem to care. Instead, what does matter more to us is who was staying in room 3. Yeah, very curious name of Kathy Rowland. And as you can probably discern, that is a very easily deciphered portmanteau / pseudonym combining both Kathy's first name and Emma's last name. I can only assume that Kathy decided to go with a different last name because, while Kathy might not be very known to people in town, if she went by Kathy Barton, people might be able to more closely associate that name with the father running the local church. Still, the receptionist doesn't seem to have much more information beyond that. He doesn't even seem to recall who Kathy Rowland might have looked like, so it actually could have been Emma who checked in and put down the name. If anything, though, it doesn't seem like Kathy Rowland has come back to the room or even used the room any time within the last couple of days, so the receptionist is a little bit concerned about the state of the room, especially considering the fact that there is no spare key to get in there to do cleaning. So, a little bit of a brick wall that we've hit in trying to get into the motel room. If only we could try to find and locate that key. I suppose if there is the possibility that it was Kathy, might be worth checking up with Father Barton to see if he might notice some stray key sitting around her room. Question is, do we really trust the father that much, considering the knowledge we've gained regarding the relationship between, you know, Kathy and the father? Maybe if we are a little bit sly, use a little bit of subterfuge, we can maybe get what we want out of the father. We just kind of have to, you know, refrain from talking about the fact she had some late night interlude with another girl in the local delinquent in a seedy motel. Yeah, sadly that's not to be the case. Matthew is very much a straight shooter and just blurts immediately out that, hey, your daughter was renting a motel room late at night with the local delinquent. Could you help us with some information on that? Strangely, Father Barton isn't too surprised by all this. I think it might be because he's had an ever-decreasing opinion regarding his now-dead daughter. Good thing is, it doesn't really seem to work against us, as it does seem like Father Barton, I think, is more than willing to try to help us out by going through his dead daughter's room. Yep, in fact, takes very little motivation for him to go scouring. And wouldn't you know it, we have managed to strike pay dirt here. We find a motel room key. Definitely matches up with the information that the receptionist had down at the motel. Just like that, we kill two birds with one stone by not only investigating the room, but by also helping out the motel receptionist. And I guess since we are being just so utterly helpful, Father Barton also has a little bit of a gift for us, I suppose. Yet again, I don't really know if this goes back to the removed money system that was supposed to be in the game. But at least Father Barton does have a bit of an excuse to give us this money, not only to pay off the room, but, you know, also just for all the troubles of having to drive up and down Cochran's Peak to visit the church. Though, I guess it is a little bit suspicious. I guess it could also be seen that he's just trying to pay us off. But, I don't know. I hate to be so suspicious of the local religious figure. Still, it's time to head back down Cochran's Peak. Check to see what we can find in motel room number 3. Not a great looking room. I can only assume these These are not the honeymoon suites. At least the good thing for us is that since nobody has been in here to clean or do otherwise, the room is in the exact same state it was whenever Mel, Emma, and Kathy were here a few nights ago. That definitely makes me think we might be able to find something useful in here in our investigation. I suppose it also works to our benefit that this is such a shabby and small room, that if there is something of interest in here, it should be pretty easy to find. First thing I want to check is in the bathroom. It looks like somebody had a little bit of an accident. Epoch. Or epoch? I always managed to mispronounce that word. Bit of a strange thing, though, to write in blood. Though I don't know, what's a normal thing to write in blood? Maybe help? Maybe get me a bandage? But yeah, outside of what is scrawled in blood and the few spatterings of blood, the only other thing that really stands out here is what could be a little end table. But instead, it was just a movable box hiding what I'm assuming to be another clue for us. It's a bit hard to tell right off the bat what this can be, but on closer inspection... Oh! I don't think I was expecting to find drugs here. And much like what was scrawled on the mirror, a similar statement of epoch is just etched onto the drugs. You can imagine, Matthew being a straight shooter, won't even smoke a cigarette, knows absolutely nothing about these mysterious drugs. So instead, it might be worthwhile to go ask the director of the hospital to see if he might have some additional information for us. And that paints an even stranger picture of what might have been going on in here, though considering what Emma had written in her diary, Kathy was on the lookout for something that Mel was trying to offer that, I guess, Emma thought they didn't really need. And I guess that was this mysterious little packet of drugs. Still, with one clue now in our pocket, it's time to go pick up another clue by heading to the gas station, where we find Winona warming herself by the little gas heater here. And as it turns out, nothing really overly suspicious with Winona here. She was actually just super excited to see what pictures had developed. It's nice to know that there is some measure of innocence here. Definitely going back to the whole connections to Twin Peaks. I think, I'm trying to remember the character's name, but, you know, definitely Laura Palmer had a very sweet and innocent friend that I think Laura wanted to keep separate from her lifestyle. Sadly, the pictures don't really offer us much insight. They were mostly all black except for one that seemed to actually turn out properly. And what does that one sole photo have? It's a view from within the forest. I don't think we've been there. Well, we've been in the forest, but we've not been to this exact no entry sign. It is a curious thing to take a picture of. Doesn't really seem to be a very scenic, you know, spot in the forest, though it also looks like there's a pretty large opening in the mountainside nearby. Winona doesn't know too much about what's beyond this no-entry gate. She only knows that it's some native tribal thing. But since it is a native tribal thing, that could also mean that Dr. James might have some more information on it, so we probably need to show this picture to him. Along with that, while we don't actually know why the no entry sign is up, it does seem like something that Sheriff Morgan might somehow might have some ideas about. So while it is only one picture, it might easily open up plenty of avenues of discussion to have with some other characters. Though I think the first thing I really want to follow up on are is that mysterious little packet of drugs we found. So while we do need to talk to James and Samuel, that makes it seem like it might be a worthwhile journey to head over to the hospital before hitting up Sheriff Morgan. Hey, look, it's on our side. Not only do we run into very happy-looking James sitting in the smoking section, but we also run into Barbara, so let's see what both of them have to think or have to say about this new photo we have. Also, it seems like almost everybody in town seems to know about the world-famous no-entry sign in the middle of the forest. Sadly, much like Winona, James doesn't really have much of an idea about why that area is blocked off. And in fact, he doesn't really give us too much in the way of information regarding, I guess, the painting that is inside the cave behind that no-entry fencing. I would have honestly assumed that Dr. James would have been more than happy to talk our ear off about anything, you know, tribal-related, but yeah, mostly just seems to be trying to push us to investigate that little cave on our own, though, yeah, Matthew is too much of a straight shooter to do that. Even very minor trespassing is just outside the range of Matthew's actions, so yeah, no matter what, I think we're going to have to get the sheriff's assistance in getting beyond that gate. And trust me when I say that we definitely want to get beyond that gate, because Barbara, in all her cryptic knowledge, apparently knows right off the bat that Emma, for some reason, I guess, went in that cave. I don't think at this point that we've actually told Barbara that these are pictures from Emma. But yeah, right off the bat, she knows that not only was Emma inside that cave, but Emma managed to have some massive epiphany by heading inside there. And also, very strangely, Barbara has seemingly more knowledge about the tribal painting inside the cave than Dr. James did. And she goes into the fact that it's a painting seeming to represent something that's beyond human comprehension, which almost makes me think that it's, I don't know, almost extraterrestrial. There's always been this underlying supernatural element in the game that's always just kind of skated around our periphery. But being as Barbara is not always very forthcoming, she immediately decides to derail from talking about this painting to asking us very morbid questions about how long we think that she's going to be alive. Thing is, though, that there is a deeper meaning with her question. It's not simply trying to goad us into, I guess, trying to have some sympathy for her. Instead, she's trying to point out the fact that she has full, complete understanding and comprehension about the fact that every living thing has to die at some point. And that for some reason, people that go in that cave suddenly seem to drop that ability to understand that death is inevitable. And considering that, I guess, Emma had some epiphany heading into the cave, I'm honestly worried that she might have had some similar delusions. Also, I managed to find out that Dr. Samuel can be in like 3 or 4 different places within the hospital. It took me a little bit of time, but I finally located him down here in his office. And it's here that we can show him and hopefully get some more information about these mysterious pills. And as you can imagine, having a teenager randomly shove pills in a doctor's face, he's a bit confused. Unexpectedly, Matthew goes on a weird tangent about thinking that these pills were just from the local pharmacy here at the hospital, but while that is strangely accusatory, Dr. Samuel does have a good counterpoint, the fact that, much like any good hospital, that, you know, they do mark everything that goes out of the hospital with the hospital's name. So I guess there's no real suspicion that, I guess, these pills came from within the hospital. And yet again, Matthew, with his limited knowledge, thinks that there's just a magic machine where you can put a pill in and it'll immediately tell you what that pill is. But yeah, drugs are not that easy to discern. So, you know, while Dr. Samuel is a little bit against helping us initially, he does think he can probably lend us a little bit of a hand. He also mentions the fact that James might be able to assist us with figuring out these pharmaceuticals, which is a bit unexpected because while we did know that Dr. James was the counselor and he has knowledge about tribal affairs, I honestly didn't know he had any knowledge about pharmaceuticals. Guess maybe we should have showed him the pills as well. Well, I guess it's a little bit too late for that, because Dr. Samuel now has the pills in hand. So I guess we are just going to have to wait a little bit to try to figure out what these mystery epoch pills are. And it's here that I want to fully admit I managed to mess up a little bit, because there's something we are going to need to do with the sheriff. And that thing is a little bit timing sensitive, so yeah, if you pay attention to the time, we're suddenly going to go back about 3 or 4 hours. And that's because, yeah, as you can kind of guess, we do need to get past that no entry fencing in the forest. And to do that, we are going to have to get some assistance from the sheriff. And I managed to do it a little bit too late. So bear in mind that we've had to do a little bit of a jump. But yeah, as everybody else has been able to kind of inform us, the sheriff does have something of a bit of knowledge regarding this no-entry sign in the forest. And there is still the general question of what in there is so, I guess, dangerous that the area has to be off-limits. I mean, yeah, it's just some cave paintings. I guess if it was a nature preserve or something that, you know, required safe investigation or preservation, I suppose. But sadly, Morgan doesn't really know. The government just told him to fence it off, and he just blindly went along with it. Though, why on earth would the government want to block it off? Yet again, it's not really tribal land or anything like that, so it's not protected or, you know, reservation or anything like that. Yeah, sadly, Morgan just has absolutely no idea. He was just doing as he was told. Also, we find out that, I guess, it's less of a cave, because I guess caves are just naturally forming, and it seems more than likely that some, you know, ancient tribe had, I guess, decided to dig out a portion of the mountain to make a painting inside the let's call it a cave. It's way too wordy to say dug out man-made area. It's just a cave. And yeah, that's probably why most of the pictures turned out dark. I guess the flash was just a little bit too underwhelming on that disposable camera. And yeah, since we've been able to discern that Emma went in there, there could be something very useful to the case, so Morgan is more than happy to go with us to check it out. And this is where that sticking point is with making sure that if you do decide to play this game, you need to get here at a very reasonable time, because Sheriff Morgan's not willing to go with you immediately. No matter what, he always puts kind of this arbitrary time limit on things. Pretty much after you initiate this conversation, he always seems to have something else he needs to do, and sadly, yeah, he always puts, I guess, this little 2-hour timer on things. And what I ended up finding out was Sheriff Morgan decides to go home and eat dinner around 5 or 6. So even though we came here at 4, my assumption was that he would just be willing to go out to the cave at 6, but nope. He was just like, well, my day's over. We'll just try to look for Emma tomorrow. So yeah, there is something that I think the translator calls event layering that I was kind of warned about, where sometimes certain events are not set at very set times. They have kind of a range of time. And that in turn can kind of unnecessarily overlap with other events to where you can actually miss them, such as phone calls, people going into buildings, different things like that. In this case, since I went too late, there's just no way the sheriff was willing and able to go out 2 hours later out to the forest here. Good thing is, having gone back, I now have plenty of time here to try to locate where this no entry sign is, because, well, we've only really been out to the forest once, and that was under, let's say, duress from a bear, so I wasn't really able to look around too much. Really take in all the beauty and grandeur of this snow-white landscape. Good thing for us is that finding the no-entry sign is pretty easy. You're just gonna follow the path here and... Alright. I think Cohen's risen on my list of suspicious characters because he might be a warlock. Still, finally get to take in the beauty and grandeur of, I guess, where the town gets its name, the lovely and titular Mizerna Falls here. And it, honestly, it looks pretty good, all considering, with the rest of the graphic limitations of the game. But yeah. Behind the trees here, we do manage to find that no-entry fencing, along with the dug-out rock wall. And there is no way to interact or jump over the fencing. So we are just going to have to wait around for about half an hour until Morgan decides to show up. Instead of being passive-aggressive and saying that, yep, we had to wait around for 3 hours doing almost nothing, we do get a little bit of a short history lesson from Morgan here. I guess these falls were very important to the local tribe whenever they did live here. Though it is a very, very short history lesson, because that's about all he's got for us. I guess to learn any more on that, hopefully we can learn a little bit more from Dr. James. Also, I do find it a bit curious that there is all this talk about local tribes and things like that. I honestly do not think that there are any Native American characters anywhere in this game, which is... I mean, it is a definite departure from Twin Peaks, where, you know, you did have the Native American sheriff's deputy. Yeah, now safely inside the darkness of the cave, we can take in this cave painting that seemed to cause such an epiphany with Emma. Thing is, from my untrained eye, I can't even begin to discern what the hell is going on in there. I mean, there's some circle up to the upper right in darkness. Looks like someone is maybe laying down, and a couple people might be overlooking the person laying down. I don't know. Seems that along with the worship of the waterfall, the local people also worship the sun, so Morgan's idea that this could be some show of worship to the sun kind of falls through after Matthew says, yeah, from what little we can tell, it doesn't really look like worship. Yeah, there's still the definite question of what this could have caused to trigger within Emma. I mean, we clearly know it's something important. Because, I mean, we did find so much evidence regarding that. Strangely, Morgan kind of takes a sudden 180-degree turn and thinks that, it's nothing. Though, pretty quickly, we do find out his reasoning for this. It's definitely not anything suspicious for why he's wanting to get out of the cave so promptly. Nope, the real reason is that he is just a little spooked by being in this dark cave. Can only assume there's been some local wise tales and folklore and urban legends that have popped up from this mysterious off-limits cave with this strange Native American painting inside of it. And yeah, since we can't really discern anything more, more than happy to let Morgan not get fully creeped out. And hey, it's our good friend, the Forest Warlock. It's strange that he seems to know that we were out here looking for something. Yet again, it would almost seem suspicious if it wasn't immediately counterpointed by the fact that, well, Sheriff Morgan is still just having him patrol the forest to make sure nothing else untoward happens out here. It's just kind of at this point that there does actually seem a bit suspicious, I guess, that Cohen was the first person to find Kathy out here, just under some supernatural feeling that the night was windless, so why not go check out this big tree? I guess maybe he did see the fire or the smoldering remains of a fire and went to go investigate that, but it just seems, yeah, it actually seems really suspicious now that Cohen did manage to find Kathy out here. Still, I mean, Morgan himself isn't really too suspicious. Seems more than happy to let Cohen out here monitoring things on his own accord. And yeah, I mean, we are making headway, but it definitely seems like we are going to have to hit up Dr. James for a whole lot more information about whatever was going on in that mysterious cave painting. So Cohen is just going to go about his normal business of teleporting in and out of the ground looking for, I'm going to assume, criminal mastermind bears. I can only assume they always work in pairs. For us, though, I think it's been a pretty eventful afternoon. We managed to get a lot more clues. We found out now there's now a strange drug angle to everything, and yeah, I can only assume that whatever is in store for us during the night, it's going to be a hell of a ride. Hopefully you'll join me then, and I'll see you later.